Ladies and gentlemen, I know what you're saying to yourselves. You're saying to yourselves, what's this show going to be like? What sort of show is it? Is it going to be full of comedy? Do you mean that'll make a change? No, don't. Listen, I can lip read.
Well, how are you? It's nice to see you again.
Yes, eh?
Yes, oh yes, nicely, thanks, yes. You know, a few aches and pains, but nothing to worry about. Because, I mean, you know, when you reach 32, I suppose you have to expect... you have to expect that sort of thing.
Frankie Howerd was one of the most enduring and instantly recognisable comedians Great Britain has ever seen. And he was also one of my all-time favourite entertainers.
Now, imagine Italy is the shape of a woman's leg. Well, Pompey is situated not quite high enough to be interesting. You understand? Yes.
As a teenager, I saw Frankie Howerd many times on stage. I met him at the stage door to ask for his autograph, and I even wrote him fan letters. So I'm thrilled to be celebrating the career of a veritable British comedy genius who radiated warmth and touched the hearts and funny bones of millions. We'll share his story and showcase his very best work from his early radio roots.
An outrage has been perpetrated upon my person. And not a nice one, it's a nasty coffee got there.
Through to his resurgence as a cult comedy hero.
You're attracting a younger audience, as we were saying.
I don't know why this is, but we've got a lot of young people. I call them the Frankie Bankers.
And you're in for a treat, because we'll be featuring rare material, forgotten performances, and Frankie's personal photographs. Join me, David Walliams, as we celebrate Frankie Howerd's greatest hits.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, I was amazed!
Frankie Howerd was quite simply unique.
Well, don't take a vote on it.
His chaotic delivery and conspiratorial humour captivated audiences and made them feel like Frankie was taking them into his confidence.
Do you know something? Here, listen. Do you know something? I found out there's a nudist colony near me. Now, would you believe that? In the middle of the town, a nudist colony? I only came across it by accident, you see. I saw this house, all these trees and that, and it's very high wall. I couldn't get over it. No, very high wall. Yeah, you have to laugh. Can you imagine that all these nudists sit down suddenly on these marble benches? It must sound like a burst of applause.
Frankie had an extraordinary ability to connect with people. He made you feel like you were listening to a friend, and within seconds, he'd hook the audience and have them on side.
Now, let's have a look at you. Oh, God. As common as muck, that one there.
Join her over here.
No. Shut up!
Ladies and gentlemen, here's Frankie Howerd.
He had an appealing honesty, a vulnerability, a heartwarming naivety of sorts, and his humour was beautifully simple.
Is he taking the mystic, do you think? Oh, wow! Oh, isn't it cold? A shiver went right up to me woggle. I was sitting at home. What's the day? It's Tuesday afternoon. And there was a tap on the door. A tap on the door. Because my plumber's got a funny sense of humour. A tap on the door. Oh, shut your face.
You're mocking naughty mockers.
He was the most natural, unnatural performer on the comedy circuit. And had a quality of surprise that kept you on tenterhooks.
One for the road. Ooh! You must have a new image, you see. They said you must show a part of yourself which has never been seen before. Shall we find out what part we're talking about first before you start guffawing? No. Don't you go say you're going to be a godsend, don't you go.
Frankie's sense of fun and mischievous schoolboy qualities made him a first-class chat show guest.
Now, wait a minute, let's make sure that you've got the same questions I've got the answers for. He invited me to his house one evening for a meal. Well, it was a meal, it was a sandwich. Well, I say a sandwich, actually it was a crisp.
I've been a lifelong Frankie Howerd fan, in awe of his unconventional genius and entertained by his meandering stories.
I'm now going to cast my pearls of wisdom before you. Here, listen, shut your face. I knew I'd listen. Some people say I'm very versatile. But others say I'm just confused, but I ignore them.
In 2008, I had the honour of playing the role of Frankie Howerd in a drama about his personal life.
Oh, no! Oh, no, Mr. Stone, no!
You shut your face, you.
No, not from your Nelly. Did he not? Did he not? Nay, nay, and thrice nay, and ye again nay.
And I know firsthand what a complex and insecure character he was.
I'm trying to get your work, Frank. Because you've got to work.
I don't want it.
Why don't you just try and get out the flat then? You know, play tennis or something.
Tennis.
Yes, you like tennis. It cheers you up.
I have of late, but wherefore I know not, lost all my mirth, forgone all custom of exercises. And indeed, it goes so heavily with my disposition that this goodly frame, the earth, seems to me a sterile promontory. Always bitter out.
What a funny man.
He learned to hide his deep-rooted insecurities and control his stage fright, and Great Britain fell in love with Frankie Howerd.
This is the one you've all been waiting for. This is Frank's turn. And listen, no, don't you talk to me about turns. I had a nasty turn last week. God help us, I did a really... Do you know something? I think I'm coming to the funny age. I do. What do you mean, it's about time? Don't be wicked. It's wicked to mock the afflicted. No. Shut your faces. Shut your faces!
Francis Alec Howerd was born on the 6th of March 1917 at City Hospital, York. His mother, Edith, worked in the local Roundtree chocolate factory, and his father was a soldier in the 1st Royal Dragoons. When Francis was just 2.5 years old, his father was posted to Woolwich, and the family relocated to Eltham, South London. It was here that siblings Sydney and Betty Howerd were born. Francis was gifted at school, winning a London County Council scholarship, one of only two awarded, to attend Woolwich County School for Boys.
We learned there reading and writing, arithmetic, all the lot, oh yeah. And, because in the, you know, these days, do you remember that all rows and rows doing our times table? Because these days they use pocket calculators. But then, oh no, those days. And looking back, we were wicked, you know. We were very naughty. That poor soul, that teacher, I feel so sorry now looking back. I think you do, you know, you poor soul. No, well, our times table. No, well, you see, she used to say, there was this Jimmy. That was, Jimmy, do your two times table nice at the end of, and she said, yeah. And he said, yeah, Jimmy. He was like, 1 2's 2, 2 2's 4, 4 2's 6. No, it isn't. 4 2's, is it? 3 2's 6, 4 2's 8. Da, 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 da. Then, listen. Then she used to pick on George. And George was a great wee. And she was clever, though. And she said, like, now, George, do your three times table. So George was at three. George, 1 3's 3, 2 3's 6, 3 3's 9, 4 3's 12. Oh, no, no. So then Maggie did have go. Because I got the hard one, love. I got the hard one, me. You know, they, do your four times table, Francis. So Maggie, la, 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 la. She said, what's that supposed to be? Well, you see that? I said, look, I can remember the tune, but I've forgotten the words. I said, what good earn of it.
Despite being shy, Frankie enjoyed amateur dramatics, earning him the nickname of the actor amongst his friends, a flag he waved with enormous pride.
I was about 13, and I was a very nervy boy, and I was very shy, would you believe I was there? And I used to... have a what they call these days an inferiority complex. And I used to have an impediment, oh dear, an impediment of speech in those days, particularly when I got nervous. And I think they all felt sorry for me, so they put me in a play called Tilly of Bloomsbury.
Now,
I
was Ian Hay.
Ian Hay, that's right.
And I played the part of Tilly's father. And that was the first time I smelt grease paint. And then I had no ego and on the stage to enjoy it, just to be part of it. And I thought it was marvellous. And it was one of the most exciting nights of my life. I completely forgot myself, but I got a good press. The local press gave me a very good notice. And the church warden said to me, Frank, he said, now, that's what you must be, an actor. An actor. So I thought, right, now I know how I'm meant to be. As a young child, I was obsessed by showbiz. And it was here that I gave my first performance, though in those days it was called Eltham Parish Hall. I used to go in for talent competitions a lot. I mean, just always plugging away at something, or talent competitions in the local cinemas or theatres. I never passed any of them, by the way. But I was always sort of kept on. I never gave in, really. Well, I'll tell you, this was the first time, first place, rather, that I shot the balls.
Francis found acting tough. He struggled with learning lines, and his stammer and nerves would often spoil his performance.
Because I went to the Royal Academy of Dramatic Art for a scholarship, and I went, what did I have to do, to be or not to be? They said, get out. You're no good. So I thought, well, I won't be an actor. I'll try and be a comic.
He said, you see, he said, the trouble with you is, he said, you're so difficult to categorise. He said, you see, you don't fit in anywhere. You're neither one thing nor the other. I don't know what he meant by that.
Francis may have been blighted by his nerves, but he was also blessed with perseverance.
Listen, Mrs., kindly tell Mr. Roscoe I'm here and you'll see me straight away. I haven't got much time to waste.
How are you?
I beg your pardon?
Who are you?
Who am I? I'm Frankie Howerd.
Who?
Well, if your own agent's never heard of you, what chance do you stand?
If Britain's Got Talent had existed in the 1930s, I'd have expected Ronnie Audex, as Frankie briefly renamed himself, to walk on stage.
I used to go in for amateur talent competitions, and anything where there was any attention, where it was important, where something depended upon it, I would go to pieces. I should go...
The only similar outlet for new talent back in his day were the amateur variety musicals, so he used these to test out material. Oh, and Ronnie Audex would have definitely got my golden buzzer for his stage name alone.
The first musical joke I ever did was about this old man, poor old boy, 82, and he went to the doctor's. So this doctor said, what's wrong? So the man said, nothing wrong. He said, the thing is I'm 82, you see, so I want you to examine me, because he said, I'm getting married. Saturday. So this doctor said, married? He said, yes, I want you to examine me and make sure I'm in good working order, because he said, I want to know to be right for the honeymoon, and I want to... So the doctor said, well, who are you marrying? So this girl, the man said, well, a girl, naturally. But the doctor said, look, don't be facetious. He said, how old is this girl? He said, 24. Doctor said, you're 82 and she's 24? Dear, oh, dear. But he said, well, he said, well, yes, he said, you don't seem to, yes, you seem to be all, yes, he said, you should. But he said, so the old boy said, I'm 82, could you give me any advice? You see, so the doctor said, well, he said, if you're 82 and she's 24, there is quite a discrepancy in the ages. Could I suggest to you took in a young lodger? Because, you see, you're out getting your old age pension. She's on her own a lot. It'll be company for her. It'll keep her happy and satisfied. You'll find it'll be a much... There'll be connubial bliss taking a young lodger. So this old boy said, I'll do that then, right. It's a young lodger. So off he went, you see. Now, a year later, he was going down the high street on his Lambretta. And, of course, this doctor saw... He said, here. So this old boy went over. He said, here. So he said to the doctor said, how are you getting on? He said, all smashing, lovely. He said, how's the marriage going? He said, all smashing, lovely. Smashing. He said, how's your wife? He said, smashing. She's just had a baby. So the doctor said, had a baby? Oh. So he said, well, how's the lodger? Oh, he said, she's had one as well. That's the first guy.
Frankie's dream of breaking into showbiz was rudely interrupted 5 months after war was declared, when, in February 1940, he received his call-up papers.
But I can't imagine you in the army. You're a sergeant as well, weren't you?
I can't imagine it.
Well, because you're hardly a man of sort of military bearing.
Is it being personal?
No. No,
yes, you are. You've been naughty, Michael. I was sympathising with you before because you said you had a bit of a bad throat tonight.
That's true, yes.
Once cutting.
Yes, No, don't. No, I mustn't.
Yes, mind you, this was in 1900. And, I was invited into which... Are we on there now? I was invited to join the army, you see. So I sent down to Shoeburyness, which is near Southend in Essex. And we did our basic training, you know, with the bayonets and rifles and boom, boom, rushing around. And then they said, go and guard Southend, which was near. So me and this other lad... Oh, Shoeburyness, please. They're being very naughty. Honestly, this is absolutely true. And there was me and this boy, and his name was a Welsh boy called Jones, and they said, fill some sandbags. You see, sand. Well, there's only shingle there, great big rock. So we had to lay on these rocks, and we slept in the bathing huts, if I was to keep at night. And you know there was that Churchill's famous words, we shall guard the beaches? Well, this is me and this boy. Waiting.
Have you got guns?
No, about 5 bullets. Each. So they said, now, look, they said, well, now, look, I don't think they're going to invade now. And if they do, let's hope he won't be there. They're going to a little place called Wakering. It's a little village in Essex. And so, and guard that. So we were walking up and down at night in the pitch black. And also, then a rumour got round that the Germans were going to drop from the sky in parachute, disguised as nuns. Disguised as nuns. Now, it was pitch black. You couldn't tell a nun from a penguin. And these rifles. You see, and you know, it really struck me after the war. I thought to myself, isn't that stupid? How can you tell? I mean, if you see 30,000 nuns running around, you must know they're not ours, mustn't you? So
right, chaps, this is the big one. The enemy is 100 yards away and still advancing. We're going over the top.
Hold it, hold it. I'm afraid we can't do that, sir. We've taken industrial action.
Industrial action?
Yes.
Good Lord, man, I'm just about to give the order to strike for home and country.
Yes, that's exactly what we're doing, sir. Striking, yes.
The army on strike?
Yes, sir.
This is worse than the general strike.
I didn't know the generals had been out as well, sir.
What's your name, soldier?
Francis, or Private Francis G.G. Howard, sir.
What's the G.G. for?
I'm in the household cavalry. We've all got G.G.'s. Isn't this witty, isn't it? Oh, please yourselves, such a face.
Frankie turned to comedy in the army, answering a call to provide entertainment to boost morale. He no longer tried to hide his stammer, and whilst embracing his mistakes, he found he got laughs.
Militza, I prostrate myself before you, but your heart is as hard as the Russian winter. My love is endless as the Siberian snow. Do I not experience a month of ecstasy when you just give me one favorable glance? Do I not suffer the pangs of remorse? Do I not suffer? If she mucks this in up... if she mucks this up, she'll get a bell ring... Oh. I'll do it again.
His nervous disposition and forgetfulness, combined with not being able to afford a scriptwriter, gave rise to Frankie's alternative style.
And in order to spin one joke out... I used to pinch the jokes, by the way, from such eminent artists as Max Miller, people like that. And I used to take a joke, and I think, now, how can I make this joke last 5 minutes instead of just doing it as a joke, just to spin it out a bit? Then I changed the end, so it won't be the same joke. So I started off by saying, well, if a joke was a man was walking down the road and met another man with two ducks, and I wouldn't do it that way. I'd say, oh, no. Yeah, well, no. You see... No, I tell you what happened. I was walking down this road. It was you know, no, you wouldn't. You haven't been there. But there was this man, you see, and I thought, that's extraordinary. I've never seen anything like this. Two ducks on a lead. I mean, it's unbelievable. See, I went on, so time I got to the end, 10 minutes had gone.
In 1946, Frankie was demobilised from the army, His confidence and life experience had vastly expanded over his 6 years of service, and he was ready to tackle show business head on.
See, a comic these days has to be what they call socially aware. They call it responsible. I mean, a comic has to make his audience think as well as laugh. Much if you feel like laughing, for goodness sake, don't stop to think about it.
To mark a new era, and to differentiate himself from all of the other Howards cluttering up the cast lists and variety bills, he changed the A to an E in his surname, and Frankie Howerd was born.
Mr. Howard's a comedian, you know.
Is he? I have been known to raise the odd titter here and there. Not here, apparently.
Greetings, citizens.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Jealous?
But you see, the public, the one thing, the first thing the public want from an artist, the most important thing the public want from an artist is sincerity. That's the important thing. The public want an sincerity from an artist. And if you can fake that, you're made.
Frankie Howerd got his big break on Variety Bandbox, BBC Radio's hour-long Sunday night show, for which half of the country regularly tuned in.
We present Frankie Howerd.
Good ladies, evening and gentlemen. Good ladies, good evening, and ladies and gentlemen, oh dear. From now on, I must rehearse everything. Wait a minute. No, listen, tonight, no. Mrs. You lay 'em, dear, I'll sell 'em. She's gonna be a godsend tonight. Thank God we've got her here.
Frankie was an overnight radio sensation, his verbal twitching becoming his trademark. Shortly after his newfound fame, he teamed up with the little-known writer, Eric Sykes, who provided most of his new material for Bandbox, like this skit with the orchestra leader Billy Turnant, broadcast in February 1951.
Good evening, everybody. Now, don't mess about now. Please. Tonight's topic is how to speak English. And I shall be assisted, with the accent on the ass, by Mr. William Turnant. Question number one. What are the continents?
Africa, Asia,
no! Continents. Not continents. Now, what are the consonants?
Now, a very funny thing happened to me as I was walking down...
What are the consonants? Do you know?
No.
Do you?
Do I?
Well, if I knew, I wouldn't be asking you, would I? He's a fool.
Give me your word and I'll twist it for you.
Now, if you give me your neck, I'll do the same.
All right, well, don't start a long rigmarole. And...
a what?
A rigmarole.
Rigmarole?
Yes.
Rigmarole.
Frankie's popularity proved such that the English as she is spoken sketch was adapted, put to music, and released the following year. And guess what? It was a hit.
I'm Francis Howerd, or have you guessed?
And Billy Turnant, too.
Now, Billy, where shall we commence?
Oh, start at the prologue.
The what?
The prologue.
Prologue?
Yes.
Prologue.
English as she is spoken is simple as ABC. But with punctuation, conjugation, phrasing, and pronunciation, then ABC's too much for me.
Mr. Turnant, be good enough to fire a question at me. Never touch me.
Well, I will also... Is that right?
No, that will never do.
Then tell me, where did I go wrong?
Well, it should be I were two.
I were two?
Yes. You was twins.
English as she is spoken, as simple as ABC. But with punctuation, conjugation, phrasing and pronunciation, then ABC's too much for me.
Oh, this song's too high.
So are you. Trouble is, you've got no tact.
Well, you haven't got much more.
Well, I'm a comic. What are you?
In the diplomatic corps.
Diplomatic?
Yes.
No. Diplomatic.
Diploma.
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 Now look, son.
Diploma. It comes from the Latin word meaning stoop down, mother. Diploma.
All right, don't show off.
By the way, what is the correct pronunciation or pronunciation?
The correct what?
Pronunciation.
Pronunciation? Pronunciation.
And that is English as she is spoken.
Now, is that the lot?
Yes.
Good.
And
this is the end. Oh, haven't you gone home yet?
Despite Frankie's popularity, throughout his career, he remained riddled with self-doubt, and he found that the only way to control his nerves was to rehearse his material over and over and over.
I was just saying, yours is a sad story. See, the point was that she was unfortunately abandoned as a baby. She was left on the doorstep. And unfortunately, it was the doorstep of the local zoo.
When it was time to perform the skits, he'd have already run his lines more than 70 times. He'd take solitary walks in the country and rehearse and perform for the wildlife.
So I went to the airport, that's where the air is, and there's our hostess there, and she's an enormous woman. She was, enormous, mind you, I like them fat, there's more to choose from. Every time she laughed, everything quivered. It took an hour for everything to settle.
Frankie remained in residence on Variety Bandbox for 2.5 years. With scripts from the likes of Peter Cook and Eric Sykes, he was a huge hit. The beauty of Frankie's comedy is that it simply doesn't age. As this classic sketch about him writing his memoirs, assisted by the incapable June Whitfield, demonstrates.
Ah, now, you are Miss Lime. Won't you sit down, dear? Not on me, dear, not on me. That's better.
Oh, and you didn't even know I was ill. I'm much better, thank you, yes.
Yes. Funny woman, isn't she? Now, perhaps we should start by discussing the fee.
2 lumps.
Yes. How old are you, Miss Lime? How old?
Oh, 4 o'clock.
Really? You don't look a day over 3:10. I think we'll give you a little test.
No, I don't wear a vest.
A test, dear, test.
No need to shout, I'm not deaf.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Not at all. Oh, I haven't got my machine switched on.
Oh, all right. Have you ever typed anyone's memoirs before?
No, but I have worked in a Scotch wool shop.
Well, I wasn't actually intending to knit my memoirs.
And before that, I worked in a laundry.
Oh, that'll come in useful. Some of the chapters will need cleaning up. Right, now let's go on with the test.
Right.
Now,
fire away.
Pardon?
Fire away.
Fire away. Right, Francis Howard's memoirs by Francis Howard. Chapter 1. It was a typical January evening when I was born. The wind was howling, the rain was falling heavily, the trees arched their backs against the storm. It was almost as if the weaker ones were cowering against their larger brethren for shelter. In fact, it was real brass monkey weather. Can you read that back, please?
Oh, I didn't get all of it.
Well, read what you got.
It was.
Well done.
It was well done.
Oh, God. Forget the shorthand. Put it straight on the typewriter. Put on the typewriter,
put
all right?
Put it on the...
That's right.
Oh,
typewriter.
Oh, now, yes.
I'll go a little bit slower, and you go a little bit faster, and we'll try and meet in the middle, as the Archbishop said to the actress.
Mr. Howard.
I'm sorry. Now, you ready?
Yes.
Fire away. Now, when I was 14...
Yes, fire away.
Oh, God, I just... When I was 14, we moved to number 5 Forest Road, Fulham. One day, when I was in bed with flu, my father said to me, Frankie, I want to tell you the facts of sex. Well, I was flabbergasted. Francis's flabber has never been so ghasted. At that moment, my father's trousers suddenly fell to the floor. It was a complete farce. Right. Read that back. But my trousers are gone then. Go on.
When I was 14, we moved to number 5, Orrest Road, Ullam.
Orrest Road, Ullam?
Yes, well, I'm sorry, I forgot to tell you there are no F's on my typewriter.
No F's? Flippin' heck. Let's have a look at that now. Let's have a look. We can't print. We can't print this. When I was 14, we moved to number 5, Orrest Road, Ullam. One day, when I was in bed with Lou, John, my father said to me, Ranky, I want to tell you the acts of sex. Well, I was labbergasted. Rance's labber has never been so gasted. At that moment, my father's trousers suddenly held to the lure. It was a complete arse.
Variety Bandbox was the springboard for Frankie's career. And whilst he loved to be adored by his fans, he was growing restless. He wanted to spread his wings further. The BBC didn't want to lose their star, and so in 1951, gave Frankie his very own television show.
Well, I've been thinking, I said, I thought I might do more or less the same sort of thing I did before.
Oh, he said, no. Oh, no, 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 no. Oh, no, 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 no.
He said, we can't have that. He said, we must find a right vehicle for you. By the way he looked at me, I think he meant a hearse.
Throughout his career, Frankie would go on to star in over 22 self-titled comedy television shows. A remarkable achievement for such a timid and self-doubting man.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I tell you a fact, something which is a fact, that you can actually die laughing. Actually die laughing. Do you realise I'm standing here saving your lives tonight?
Many of the sketches in his self-titled shows were as simplistic as his stand-up. They were filled with anticipation, the audience knowing what was going to happen, but not quite how or when.
Lot 47, a Chinese vase of the Ming Dynasty from the Summer Palace in Peking, formerly in the collection of Dr. Rosenthal of Geneva. I have a bid of 20,000 guineas. Do I hear 21? 21. 2. 3. 24,000 guineas. 5. 25,000. 6. 7. 8. 28,000 guineas. Any advance on 28,000 guineas? 29. 30,000 guineas on my right. I am bid 30,000 guineas. Any advance on 30,000 guineas? 30,000 guineas once, 30,000 guineas twice. Lot 48.
Frankie didn't tend to play returning characters in his sketches, although over his career, he would revisit one or two that hit the mark with audiences. A personal favourite of mine is his alternative vicar.
The subject of my sermon today is sin. That's woken a few up, hasn't it? Oh, bless you. Bless you. Member of the congregation at Libbing, I'm so sorry. My friends, an overwhelming tide of pornography is threatening to engulf us all. It has even arrived at this small and fair village of ours. What, you say? What? Or, of course, deeper if you're a baritone.
What, you say?
What, you say? Pornography in much rutting in the wold? Impossible. But nay,
Nay, thrice nay, and yea again nay. It is not impossible, because I have seen it with my own eyes. Brethren, the things I saw yesterday at the jumble sale in the village hall, church hall, distress me beyond words. I think at this time it might be advisable if the verger would dismiss the choir boys. And no earwigging in the vestry. Go. Brethren, as I was saying, the jumble sale, I was appalled. Some of the titles on Mrs. Daly's second-hand bookstall were a disgrace. And whereas we are very grateful for the £95.10 she took, I'm afraid I cannot condone it. An illustrated copy of White Thighs alone changed hands for £7.10, and this is not right. Particularly as page 34 was missing. Now, I would be happy to report that this was an oversight, that this was the only offending title. But alas and alack, the trestle table was sagging with porn. Items like the lustful Turk, the passionate flesh, and our old friend Fanny Hill mingling shamelessly with Biggles Goes West.
Vintage 1853.
Oh, really? Were you there for the treading?
Frankie Howerd was one of Britain's most beloved comedians. Not a joke teller as such. Instead, he entertained his audience with rambling stories, occasionally remembering to throw in the odd punchline.
If you cross your legs towards somebody, it means you're attracted to them. If you cross your legs away from somebody, it means you're not. And if you keep crossing your legs backwards and forwards all night, it means you got your knickers on back to front.
His gossipy performance, unique delivery, and cheeky innuendos made him a household name.
Do not adjust your set. There is a fault in the script.
Frankie Howerd was quite simply a comedy genius.
You're at the North Pole, and all of a sudden, why not? They do package tours everywhere these days. Now, there you are, you see a polar bear emerge from its ice hole. Now, and... excuse me, I'll repeat that for this lot. Polar bear emerged from his ice hole. Are you sure this crowd's from the university?
Frankie's television shows mix stand-up monologues and sitcom. In each episode, he'd take the audience on a themed journey, during which the two comedic disciplines would fuse.
Supercilious bugger.
To fully appreciate how unique and avant-garde this structure was, the following excerpt is best enjoyed in its entirety.
I think loneliness is a terrible thing, you know. Oh, I do, especially when you're on your own. I mean, at night times. No, don't. No, please. Don't mock. Mocking? Who's mocking? No, but I mean, I think night times are the worst, don't you? I mean, I think it's a terrible thing to be in bed on your own. No, I mean... On your own, in bed. To be on your own bed. It's sitting in a chair, it's just as bad. And I know I've always said, you're better off on your own, but still, you see, I was young there when I said that, full of bravado. Because I think when you're young, you don't need people so much, do you? But I think when you, you know, sort of come to a... You know, when you sort of approach a more... When you reach a kind of a more... When you're getting past your education... You need somebody, don't you? Well, you know what I mean. Someone to have a good moaning in the morning. Someone to give you a good excuse for not going home at night. And, oh, it must be marvellous to have someone to keep away from. But I've always been lonely, you know. I've always been a shrinking violet. Shrinking, missus, shrinking. Full of sympathy, look at that. Laughing her head off. It's wicked to mock the afflicted, dear. Mind you, I don't want you to think I'm ready for my wheelchair yet. Oh, no. Oh, no. The dog end isn't out completely. Oh, no. There's still a few puffs left in it. But, you see, it's not that. It's, the thing is, it's more mental with me. It's more mental. I mean, I'm beginning to feel lonely. It's beginning to get on top of me, because a couple of days ago I was in my bed sitting room, sitting on the bed, and it suddenly came home to me. I was depressed. I never felt so bad. Do you know, for 1 minute, I was seriously considering the gas oven. No, it was no good, because it was only one of those tiny bachelor ones. It's a hard enough job getting your foot in. And I said to myself, Francis, this is not the answer, not the coward's way out. Pull yourself together, you blithering fool. Because I often talk to myself like that, you know. I don't care what I say to myself. No. I give myself a right lashing sometimes. I said, Francis, you are still young. Now get out into the world and find yourself a mate. There's a lot of lonely people in this world. How do they get on? They advertise. So I went round to the Continental News Agents and I looked at his adverts. Funny, aren't they all? Very funny. Most of them don't offer friendship so much as discipline. Lots of stern governesses advertising. Oh, most odd. But anyway, in the end, I decided to contact a Lonely Hearts Bureau. And there's one pinned up on the wall, the address on the wall, at the end of my street. It's Janice Goodbody, Personal Introductions. So I put my pride to one side and made an appointment and went round to see her.
Come in. Yes?
Oh, excuse me. I'm looking for a Janice Goodbody.
How do you do?
Beg your pardon?
Well, that's me. I'm Janice Goodbody.
Oh.
Limited.
Well, I should think you must be. Very limited. I beg your pardon. I'm sorry, I was expecting to see a lady.
Oh, yes, they all do. I've been Janice Goodbody since I left the army.
Oh. Was it painful?
I bought this company with my gratuity. You see, I didn't want to change the name because of the goodwill.
I understand. Yes, of course, the company. Yes,
yes, I'm sorry. Now, if you'd like to sit down there, make yourself comfortable.
Yes, thank you very much.
Tell me all your troubles.
Oh.
You'll find me a very sympathetic listener.
Oh, I'm sure, because you've got a kind face. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Yeah.
One feels such a nana, doesn't one?
Come along. There's no need to be embarrassed.
No. All right, then. Well, it's like this, Janice. You don't mind if I call you Janice, do you?
Well, no, not in here, I don't. But if we meet on the streets, it's Jocelyn.
Jocelyn? I think he's better off with Janice, don't you? I wrote to you last week.
Oh, yes. I remember. Let me have a look through the file here.
Yes.
Ah, yes. Now, are you disillusioned of Exeter?
No.
Past it of Hounslow?
Dead.
Frustrated of...
No.
Well, who are you, then?
Shy but sexy of Wallam Green.
I see. Just a minute. I think I might have your letter here. Yes, here we are.
Ah, yes. Thank you.
Yes, let's see now.
I hope he isn't going to read it out loud. Well?
Well, we can't guarantee all this, you know.
What do you mean by that? A cup of tea in bed of a morning isn't too much to ask, is it?
Well, I'm a bona fide businessman.
Yes, and my Fridays are as bona fide as yours, mate. So now then...
The sole aim of the Janice Goodbody Bureau is to bring together lonely hearts of opposite sexes so that in the fullness of time they will achieve happiness and contentment, respect and friendship, a mutual comfort, a union of consummate beauty.
Yes. I suppose you could put it that way.
At a price not to exceed £3.10 an introduction.
£3.10? Just to say hello, girl?
Plus 7 and 6 per subsequent meeting, 30 shillings on the announcement of the engagement, 10 guineas on celebration of the wedding stakes, and charge a penalty clause of 5 guineas if you decide to turn it in halfway through.
Isn't it romantic? And do you give green shield stamps?
There is another way. Oh. We have a special 50-guinea all-in voucher.
50-guinea?
Yes, this entitles you to a look through the book and a go at any 40 from 80.
Is that their ages?
No, certainly not. No, no, no. This represents the cream, you see, the cream of the Bureau.
Ah.
Just a few samples.
I see. Yes. Oh, a bunny girl. Judging by her ears. Ooh, this is a good one of you, isn't it? Oh, no idea you're a wrestler, look.
How'd that got in there?
Oh, I beg your pardon. Oh, so this is the cream, is it?
Yes,
well, it's been standing a bit too long, I think. I'm not paying you 50 guineas for rubbish like that. I've got a bigger book of stuff like that out on my own. Now, I want something special. I'm looking for something more Elizabeth Taylor-y or even Ursula Andress-y.
All right, well, I'll have a look.
No, don't bother. If you have to have a look, it means you haven't got one. Oh, I don't know. I don't think it's worth the expense.
Expense? How can you count the cost when in those drawers over there may be the very girl you're looking for?
Well, I never saw anybody come in. Where? Oh, at the filing cabinet. I beg your pardon. Yes, you're right. I've been lonely too long, yes. All right, I'll go on with it then.
All right, well, then let's get down a few particulars.
Yes.
Now, if I know the sort of type that you are and the sort of type that you're looking for, mm-hmm. I may be able to make a few suggestions.
Yes, I understand. Well, take it. Ask anything you like, anything at all. I've nothing to hide.
All right, well, yes. Here we go then. How old are you? I said, how old are you?
I heard what you said.
Now, come along, please, come along now.
32. 32 and a bit.
What's the bit?
Well, I don't know, that's what I've come here for.
And what is your religion?
Well, is Sam worshipper all right?
No, it is not.
Oh, well, put down Methodist then. Right. Put down Methodist, yes.
Methodist.
Yes.
And what are your politics?
Oh, yes. Oh, politics. Very strong. Oh, certainly. I'm a raving don't know. I never have been. Always. Isn't it?
Medical history?
Oh, confused. Utterly confused. You see, some people say I've had it. Other people say I haven't had it.
And have you had it?
Not lately, no.
Tell me, is there any insanity in your family?
Oh, no, not much. I mean, nothing to write home about, you know.
I see. Mm. Any particular hobbies?
Well, actually, I used to collect jam jar labels.
Did you really?
Yeah, well, I've packed it in now because the album, I couldn't open the album, you see, it was too sticky. So now I just confine myself to early Byzantine music, Mexican Indian pottery and bingo.
Well, that seems to be all in order. Now, tell me, have you any particular preference for the type of partner you're looking for? I mean, do you like them blonde, brunette, redhead, tall, short, slim, well-built?
Yes.
I see. Well, I think that's as much as we can do at the moment.
All right.
There is... don't like to have to bring this up, but... Have you a police record?
What?
Have you a police record?
Yes, that one. Inspector Barlow singing Tea for Two, you know. Very good. What a silly Billy. I'm sorry. You mean, have I ever been nicked? Well, once I did commit a minor infringement.
Really? What was that?
No, look, he's getting interested now the dirt's coming out. Look. Yeah, well, I'm sorry, I can't tell you. It was too shameful.
Now, come on, now, please, you must tell me. Now, what was it? Now, what was it? What was
I've got him going now. I've got him going now.
I insist. Now,
Janice! Stop twitching. For your sake, good grief, woman, control yourself.
Don't ever do that again.
Oh, I shan't. I've never touched a pair since, I swear.
All right, well, I think that's all for the moment now. But if you happen to have a photograph of yourself, you could let me have, and then I could, you know what I mean? punt it around and see if there's any interest.
Yes. Well, we'll do it the best you can. Give it a... Have a good punt. Have a good punt. Yes, and I'll tell you something else. I should be very, very grateful if you could try and fix something up for me before the winter's finished, because it's either that or installing central heating, you see. And, I mean, I can't go on much longer the way I am. Where's this photograph now? Here we are. Well, I'm sorry. It's the only one I've got. It was taken last year when I was playing Richard III. You see, tell them that the nose and the hump are both removable.
Oh, right. Well, won't be good, isn't it? Yes, well, I think that's all, my friend. Welcome to our happy circle. I shall be getting in touch with you very shortly. And don't worry, I feel sure that your days of loneliness are numbered.
Ah, thank you, Janice. That's You're good. Very kind.
That's all.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
Excuse me, am I intruding?
Let me introduce you. This is Mr. Shy but Sexy of Wallham Green. And this is Yvonne.
I'll take it. Don't bother to wrap it up. What service? I shall recommend you to the Consumers' Council.
Come, my dear. Now, Yvonne happens to be my wife.
Wouldn't you believe it? Just like my butcher, always keeps the best bit for himself.
Name?
If you were to glance up, the question would be superfluous.
Name?
Frankie Howerd was a national treasure.
I'm a bit poorly myself, really. Thank you, that's right, get your R's out.
His genius was greater than ever he realised.
Because, no, I've... I woke up this morning and I sort of felt funny. And
he made serving 24 carat comedy gold look easy.
But I tell you why. Because I abhor rudeness. I abhor rudeness. Do you? I do. I abhor rudeness. Isn't that a lovely word, abhor? Abhor. Oh, I use that a lot. Oh, I abhor. It's a lovely word. I abhor. I could use that all night. I could go on.
I abhor.
Or higher. I abhor.
Wait a minute.
Wrong for the road. I abhor.
Frankie Howerd didn't only make it big on the small screen. He starred in feature films too. And although he needed persuading to take on his first role in The Runaway Bus, when he'd committed, he was happy to muck in and offer suggestions too.
Because these days they spend $9 million or pounds on a film, and the producer of this film came to me to make this comedy thriller, and they had £45,000, which isn't much for a film, and one studio, and they had this coach. So he said, "How can we go through a whole film with this £45,000? And we can't, because we can't afford to go out of the studio." So I said, "Well, set the whole thing in a fog." I said, "And you won't." You won't need any scenery, you see. So the whole thing was in a fog.
Yes,
never
was.
Saw any scenery.
Yes.
Never went out the studio.
No.
Wrong door.
There was much evidence of the fog throughout The Runaway Bus, and the storyline was expertly crafted to reinforce this theme.
Look, I don't ask much out of life. I could ask for a rise, a bonus, danger money, but I don't. I ask one thing only. How do I get to the main entrance?
Will the driver of relief coach 13 come to the main entrance?
Are you the driver of the coach?
Yes.
Well, why aren't you over at transport?
Because. I felt my way to the canteen, had a cup of tea, and then in quick succession, I lost me way, me bearings, me coach, and me temper!
When does all this nonsense stop?
I beg your pardon.
And so you should.
Considering Frankie's first feature role saw him playing opposite the extremely experienced film actress Margaret Rutherford, he held his own well. And what's more, he even got to ad-lib additional scenes and was overjoyed that they made the final cut.
Hello, Gran? Gran? Grandma? I can't hear a word you're saying, dear. Oh, I bet she's got a shawl in her mouth. That's better, yes. Look, let me do the talking, dear, because this is costing me money. I said it's costing me money.
In 1956, Frankie starred as a hotel porter in a pleasant little romp, A Touch of the Sun.
I say, darling.
Oh, hello, Miss Dryer.
Listen, darling.
The script afforded lots of opportunities for him to show off his character mirroring skills and range of accents.
I promise.
You really are an absolutely divine young man.
Oh, rot. Oi, for I show Mr. Cairn up to 274 and 275. Now, sir, if there's anything you want, all you got to do is to ring me on the telephone and I'll be happy to accommodate you all.
The script is full of charm, and Frankie's cheeky ad-libs fit in perfectly.
For he is yours, and they say, love me, love my dog.
Oh, you're incorrigible. Well, I must take Prince for his walk, or he gets cross. Come along, Princey.
Au revoir, Miss Phillips.
Instead of being confined to only the studio, the film's budget allowed location shoots. This added opportunity to exploit Frankie's physical comedy. The standout sequence in the film sees Frankie go undercover as a duchess, a scene in which he doesn't even need to open his mouth to raise laughs.
Good evening, Duchess.
Oh, how do you do?
All right.
Now, not too near the knuckles.
Won't you join us, Duchess?
Oh, thank you so much. Would you mind steering that way? That's it. Thank you so much.
Frankie was like a magpie and would borrow material from other comedians. And in this scene, he employs the use of George Formby's famous catchphrase.
Turned out nice again.
Glass of champagne, Duchess.
Oh, no, I never touch it, only at launching.
Just a tot, Duchess.
No, no.
You must.
No, no.
Now do.
No, no.
All right, then, Sam.
Well, if you insist. Thank you.
I feel it's something. As a projectionist, there is one film I don't think I would dare show. And that is the film I was in called The Cool Mikado.
Anyway, it must be better than television. What do you say,
Frankie's
boy?
Films didn't all hit the mark, and he regretted his appearance in director Michael Winner's 1963 flop, a ramshackle rehash of Gilbert and Sullivan's famous comedic opera.
The flowers that bloom in the spring breathe promise of merry sunshine. As we merrily dance and we sing, we welcome the hope that they bring. Oh, the summer of roses and wine. The summer of roses and wine. Well, that's what we mean when we say that a thing is welcome as flowers that bloom in the spring.
Frankie gave the role his best shot, but the whole film was considered a jumble by the critics. Even Lionel Blair and his leaping dance troupe couldn't save the picture. Two years later, in 1965, Frankie joined the Centrinians brand, although his hopes of a critical hit were dashed as the Great Centrinians train robbery lacked the charm of the first three 1950s classics. Frankie plays the good-natured baddie and approaches the role with gusto. The charm he is able to bring to a scene is simply magical.
Voila! Justice has taste.
Alphonse, I distinctly asked for a bronze rinse. This is pink. I look like an anemic turkey.
Oh, isn't Sarah a wicked tease? This is the last mow in masculine tonsory. Riviera Peach. I'll show, sir. Why, it hasn't even penetrated the West End yet.
Oh, really?
No, sir. I had to go to Monty for its unveiling.
Did you?
Yes, sir. Now, here we are. Vladimir Rabowski of the Paris Ballet, wearing it in Swan Lake.
Mm. Oh, well, if Vladimir can dance with it in Paris, I...
May we?
Suppose I can bowl them over on Richmond Green.
A bully for sir.
Despite the plot being generally below par, Frankie puts in some strong performances. The highlight being his distraction Morris dancing to save the robbery from being foiled.
I'll explain after 32 bars. Don't stand there, ossified. Dance!
I know that face, surely.
In 1968, Frankie made his first appearance in the Carry On franchise in Carry On Doctor, was enough to cement Frankie Howerd as a key player in the history of the franchise. He showed initial reluctance before accepting the part.
What the devil's going on?
He was particularly nervous about Carry On Doctor, as joining such an established franchise unnerved him.
This is a mad...
Trademark looks to camera.
With any luck.
Whilst Carry On producer Peter Rogers ignores...
Oh, no, I don't think so. We want him to enjoy it, don't we?
He knew that Frankie's on-screen persona cast a long shadow on the rest of the film. So, in his second and final role for the franchise, he diluted Frankie's on-screen persona and made him stick rigidly to the narrative.
Oh, the indignity of it all. I, Professor Tinkle, ornithologist, trussed like a chicken.
In 1973, Frankie starred in The House in Nightmare Park, which is a cross between a Hammer horror and a Carry On film. Frankie's cast as essentially an Edwardian version of himself, and later said that this was one of his favourite film roles. His final performances in a feature film is confident.
Hello?
And he clearly appears to be enjoying it. Frankie Howerd was one of the great survivors of British comedy.
Smile, love. He looks miserable as sin.
His career had great highs.
You got your troubles. What about the deep sea diver who came up for air and passed his ship sinking, eh? Think of that. No, the thing is...
But it also had crashing lows.
He said, after all, he said, you've got a sort of musty ambience of a bygone age. A sort of mouldy patina of incipient decay. A sort of fossilised... I said, all right, don't go on. I've got the drift.
In the late 1950s, producers began to view Frankie as being difficult to work with and considered his humour outdated. Whilst hurtful at the time, it was something Frankie was able to poke fun at later in his career.
I'll be absolutely honest with you.
Yes. That,
you know, he's not my cup of tea.
Oh, the funny one?
Mr. Frankie Howerd.
He's not?
No, not in most respects. I mean, it is, I suppose, the most annoying thing is the waffle.
What waffle?
Well, this perpetual waffle that goes on. I mean, it's, oh, oh, and oh, dear. Oh, don't take a vote in it. Oh, it'll go, I'll make myself comfy and all that.
You don't like that?
Well,
yes. Oh, I find it rather endearing.
Prone to melancholy and deep depression, Frankie struggled with falling out of favour.
I couldn't get in work. I became unfashionable, I suppose. And I lost confidence. And I got very down. And there is an old expression which you've heard, I don't, no doubt. It never rains, but it pours. And it is often true in life that if one thing leads to another, it's like a vicious circle. You lose your nerve, and then you don't do so well, and then you're not wanted, so you lose your nerve more. Then you don't do so well, it goes on and on, and gradually you can sort of spiral downwards. I went into nightclubs, would you believe? Because I was a bit desperate and I needed money. We have to live on something, you know? One, I had to keep going. I worked when I could. I mean, yes. I did one or two summer seasons. Mm-hmm. And I just had to sort of struggle on, hoping to get out of it one day, out of a sort of valley, which I hope one day I would get through. And thank God I did. So I was in a terrible state for about 3 years. And then I made what is, as you say, this comeback. I did a thing at the establishment club, and I went on the BBC in the, that was week that was.
And now the week at Westminster, and our lobby correspondent is Mr. Frankie Howerd.
I thought I ought really to explain what I'm doing here in the first place, because as you perhaps know, I'm not normally... I'm usually associated with a variety, you know, variety comedian, you know, music hall, and I'm not usually associated with these sophisticated wags and wits, you know, these youngsters. And, you know, I'm more sort of Billy Cotton, me. And, you know... And so I thought I want to apologise in a way. Why should someone drop something? Come on, I shall drop a few tonight, so don't worry. No, that's what they call ad-libbing. You never get that on this programme. Now,
political satire wasn't in Frankie's DNA, yet he did his best to embrace the subject matter.
Budgets, right, for my mates and myself. I call this a children's budget. I don't mean for children. I mean, for instance, if you have children, a lot of children... I mean, if you have five children, for instance, this eases your tax position, you see.
Mind you, I do think this is a bit difficult. I mean, it penalises those who like to keep themselves to themselves. If you know what I mean.
Well, I mean,
Could you please? No, please.
Frankie's mix of soft satire and his old faithful material put him back on the comedy radar. Offers of work picked up again, and he was about to take on one of the most pivotal roles of his career, the part of Pseudulus the Slave in A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum. The American producers knew they'd struck gold casting Frankie, who took effortlessly to the part and made it his own.
Lycus, can I see you back here a moment, please?
The genesis of the role can be seen in this rare rehearsal footage.
Now, wait a second, I got a better idea. I'd live as much as you want because they'll be laughing here. Go ahead, here.
I am asking.
When the musical opened, British producer Michael Mills watched Frankie's performance on stage and saw something in his portrayal of Pseudulus that he knew would translate very well on television. Frankie's exaggerated ad-libs sparked an idea.
No, I'm sorry. May I see the next girl, please?
Let go! Don't do it! Let go! Drop it!
And so he set about creating what would become Frankie's most celebrated role.
Oh, dear! Oh, you naughty little dog!
Lurkio was born.
The prologue! Let's get on with the prologue now. The prologue. Someone leaking. Oh, it's you, mistress. She's hissed again.
Frankie's most successful television work was to be in situation comedy, and the audience lapped up the bawdy tone and double entendres up Pompeii served.
Lady, would you leave us alone? Oh,
certainly.
Yes.
Now then, let's get down to it.
Yeah, excuse me. Look, I must go and do the prologue, if you'll excuse me.
Wait! You don't know who I am.
Yeah, but it's not who you are that worries me, it's what you are. Excuse me.
They call me Spartacus.
Spartacus?
Ah, I see that rings a bell.
Yes, and talking of ringing a bell, I could use a tinkle. Excuse me.
Stay where you are.
Don't either. Here, listen, who made your suit? I should take that back. There's a sleeve missing.
Oddly, for a comedian who already had a reputation for off-colour humour, Frankie was apprehensive about the risque and near-the-knuckle jokes in the script and insisted that the BBC pilot the idea.
What do you expect, wit?
He needn't have worried, as the series achieved critical acclaim and the ratings topped 12 million viewers. Even today, Frankie is probably most closely associated with Up Pompeii in the mind of the television viewing public.
Look, don't push. Now, look, a former cue. Now, let's see. Oh, look! Oh, yeah, control yourselves, please. Now, look. Oh! Come on, there's one more. Come on. Ooh. That's a lot.
Frankie was one of the first comedians on television to use a sides to camera.
We've got a common lot here tonight, I'll tell you.
Nobody knows for certain, but it's suspected that Frankie saw Norman Evans do something similar in his act and decided to make it a staple of his own routine.
I'll tap out a message in Morse's codeine. Who are you? Please answer. They're answering. Please stop banging. There's people here trying to sleep. Charming, isn't it?
His looks to camera certainly became a motif in Up Pompeii, and the technique went on to inspire modern-day comedians such as Miranda Hart.
Did he just call me sir?
And Phoebe Waller-Bridge.
Someone outside the gate.
Hey, Roman, come here.
Hey?
Will you come here a minute?
There's a foreigner. There's a fugitive from Coronation Stratus.
Oh, your lips. Your lips are like ripe cherry jaunts. Your throat is like a swan's. Your shoulders are like... Wait a minute. Your shoulders are like the Venus de Milo. Your bosoms are like the round hills of Rome.
What are my eyes?
I'm not going that way, I'm sorry.
Frankie starred in three spin-off Pompeii feature film releases, But it was only the first that really captured the same magic as the television series.
Come on, bigger. Don't be ashamed of it. Bigger! All right, don't go mad.
The feature film budget meant more ambitious sequences, but really it was the same hit comedy recipe, only with more money to spend on the trimmings.
Impressive, isn't it? I'd tell you what it cost to build, what with the price of matchboxes these days. Still, copulatum expensium, as we Pompeians say. Now, I should be around here somewhere, in the marketplace. Yes! There.
I say, it's rude to point.
What makes the Up Pompeii cinematic experience such a joy is the fact that Frankie hadn't changed his performance one bit for the feature film.
Looks like your master's having another orgy tonight, Lurkia.
Yes, I'm afraid he is. He's having one of his at homes. This time it's to celebrate the festival of the prolific goose.
Laying all night. Well, it's all right for them, but it's me who has to clear up all the mess.
You see it?
Do you know? Clearing up after the last one, I came across a couple left over from the orgy before. You'll never guess what the woman was saying to the man.
Come on, hurry up. I've got others waiting.
How did you know?
Up the Chastity Belt, which followed the release of the Up Pompeii feature, used the same tried and tested humour, yet in a medieval setting. Frankie played dual roles, King Richard the Lionheart and peasant Lurkalot. And despite the change of setting, his characters continued to address the audience directly.
Here they come.
Charge!
Oh, no. Everyone's seen that gag. Haven't you? Well, I'll carry on then. Oh, well. These old gags are the best.
One, two, three, go!
The film didn't take itself seriously at all, and the script was knowing and written as if in on the joke.
You can't say you aren't getting your money's worth.
In the film, Frankie was supported by such strong comedic performances from the likes of Hugh Paddock as Robin Hood.
Well, Ducky, what do you think of our camp?
Oh, I think that's the word for it. Lovely.
Oh, Lurkalot, aren't they magnificent in their Lincoln green?
They certainly are.
It is lovely colour, isn't it? Designed them myself, you know.
Did you?
Oh, yes. Mind you, I prefer our winter outfits best.
Yes.
Black leather.
Oh.
Cut very tight across the hips. Open thonging up the chest.
Very boyish.
Of course, we're not looking our best at the moment.
No.
Lost most of our sequins.
Oh, how maddening.
Havoc. It's all this swinging through the trees, you know.
You swing?
Oh, every night.
Yeah, I guessed it.
2 decades after Frankie's first outing as Lurkio, he was persuaded to dust off the toga and revisit Pompeii for a one-off special, although this time for a different channel.
Oh, hello. Welcome, citizens, and greetings. Long time no see. Oh, yes. What, it must be XX years now. Oh, at least. Yes. Doesn't Tempus Fugit. Mind how they tell me, I don't know what you think. They tell me I haven't changed a scrap. What do you think? Please yourselves. Anyway, let's make yourself comfy. Yes. Shut your face. Pardon me. Now, oh dear, I wish they'd worn these damn steps up. Well now, the prologue. Since we last met, much water has passed over the aqueduct. Yes. It is not now BC. It is not now BBC. Oh, nay. The clocks have been turned forward. It is now AD. Actors desperate.
The ITV revisit was a ratings winner, and audience and critics alike enjoyed the return to ancient Rome. London Weekend Television wanted to produce more episodes, yet Frankie resisted, believing that less was more. In the 1980s and 90s, Frankie became a staple on the chat show circuit, and sometimes he was persuaded to do more than just chat.
All you gotta do is very simple, just stand there. Just stand.
Even when the darkest clouds are in the sky, when things go wrong, you mustn't cry. Spread a little happiness as you go by. Please try.
What's the use of worrying?
What's the use of worrying?
Feeling blue.
Feeling blue.
When things go wrong.
When things go wrong.
Keep on smiling through.
Keep on smiling through.
Spread a little happiness.
Spread a little.
Shut up!
Surely you'd be wise to make the best of every blues day.
Mind your trust. Don't you in for this, boys.
Mind your trust. Mind your hammers.
You're so right. Your golden Tuesday.
Even when the darkest clouds are in the sky, you mustn't sigh and you mustn't cry. Spread a little happiness as you go.
Just quickly, before we go, I want to say that I had no idea at all that you could sing so well. Really, you have a marvellous voice. I mean that very sincerely.
What a lovely thing to say, Frank. That's beautiful.
Shocking, wasn't it?
Believe, this is my record. Right, go. Now down in the meadow, in a little fishy pool, lives three little fishes and a mama fishy too. Now swim, said the mama fishy, swim if you can. Are you taking the mickey? So they swam and they swam right over the dam. There was George. Didn't Dad want me? There was Purse. Didn't Dad want me? And there was Cecil. He was a snob. He was dying to get into an aquarium. So they swam and they swam right over the dam. All right, whoa! Don't stop that again. Right. Now stop, said the mama fishy. You'll get lost. I'll pay you. Ooh! I hope you won't get the impression I'm mad, because I'm not. But the three little fishes weren't going to be bossed. Come on, they said, let's go out on a spree. Oh, so they swam and they swam right down to the sea. George, didn't Dad want me? Purse, didn't Dad want me? So they swam and they... Wait a minute, we've lost Cecil. Cess, come on, boy, get up there. Didn't Dad want me? Well, there's no need to fly into a passion. So they swam and they swam right down to the sea. Gosh, it's the little fishes, here's a lot of fun to play around here until day is done. This is ridiculous, isn't it? They swam and they swam and it was a lark. Till all of a sudden they saw a shark. Wait a minute, I'm choking myself. Never mind. Oh, said the little fishes, here's a lot of whales. So quick as they could, they turned on their tails. Ah, that shook you, didn't it? You thought the needle had stuck. I'm a little tinker. And back to the pool in the meadow they swam. They swam and they swam back over the dam. George, didn't Dad want me? Purse, didn't Dad want me? Cecil, quickly. Oh, no. Well, that was the end of the three little fishes who ended their lives as whale meat dishes. And here's the moral. Never disobey your mam and swim over the dam.
or you'll end up as ham, lamb, or jam. And now, scram.
Frankie recorded Three Little Fishies in 1949, and little did he realize back then that he'd still be performing the song on stage four decades later. In the early 1990s, Frankie experienced newfound popularity as a cult comedy figure. Old routines and familiar catchphrases delighted a new young crowd. The crowning glory of this renewed adulation was a performance at the Oxford Student Union, which was recorded for television. It was widely considered to be one of Frankie's most accomplished performances.
Well, you know. No, you don't know, but I mean... No, but you'll believe me when I tell you I'm not what you call an intellectual. I'm not a... No, I'm not what you call brainy. You know, a sort of clever clogs. I'm not levels, O-levels and A-levels. Oh, no, not that. Because you're all students. So, naturally, to you, I'm not what you call an academic. By no way at all could you call me an intellectual. And the... Which is why I feel so much at home here tonight. Shut your face.
Is mocking. No.
Mocking. No, I tell you, this show got off to a bad start anyway. That's why I'm so jittery tonight, because you'd have died. I was sitting about a month ago. I was sitting at home, 6 weeks. I was sitting at home one night watching the telly, and the phone rang, you see, and it was my agent, and that was a shock in itself, I'll tell you. So he said to me, he said, how would you fancy a one-night stand? So I said, I'd love it. I said, a morning stand or an afternoon stand, I wouldn't care less. I said, where is this one-night stand? He said, it's the Oxford Union. Well, I mean, naturally, I thought that was a pub. I mean, well, it is. This is confession time already. I thought perhaps a theatre restaurant. You see, I didn't realise it was a chapel. And so I got out. I got here earlier today, and I was coming through the arch, the porch across the yard there, and I saw this man. Well, this man saw me actually. He was a porter, I suppose. He's a porter. He said to me, "Excuse me." He said, "Are you Frankie Howerd?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Dear God, I thought you were dead." I said, no, I'm very much alive and kicking, if you know what I mean. Because you have to be quick in this business, you have to be streetwise, you have to quick, you know, quick in the uptake. Oh, yes. So I said, now look, I'll do the, I said this man, this gent, I said, I'll do the jokes. I said, will you tell me about the show? I said, now, will there be a good crowd tonight? See, this is sort of, he said, yes. So I said, well, do you think there'll be an understanding crowd? He said, yes. Well, he said, I hope so. They're expecting Ben Elton. So I said... So as quick as a flash, without a moment's hesitation, I said, I'll bugger off. No.
He drew on a lifetime of material and featured the very best gags and stories which he'd perfected over the decades. And naturally, the outing of the catchphrases went down a storm.
Go. Oh, no! Oh, no, Mrs. Oh, no! Oh! Oh! No! All right. I'll do an encore. I don't usually do encores till the end. If I get to the end. All right. No, not on your Nelly. You shut your face, you. Oh, titty-ing not. This is...
Oh, nay, nay, thrice and nay, and yea, dame, nay. It's coming out now, you see. It's all coming out. Coming out in a torrent now.
Such whimsicality.
And there was... That's your face. It's mocking, mocking Francis. You're so hurtful. They can be so hurtful they want to be. That's a joke. That's a joke. No.
Excuse me. We've got an hour of this, so try and reconcile yourself.
A cracking close to the show saw Frankie revive his eccentric country vicar for what would be his final outing.
I trust that this is a leftover from last week's Harvest Festival. And not placed here with the idea of seeing me go surplus over cassock into the font.
Nevertheless, dearly beloved,
this skin, this discarded outer covering, is rather symbolic with regards to today's service, which, as you all know, is a service of thanksgiving for the first anniversary of our local nudist colony. Here in our village of much rutting in the world.
And I'm very pleased
to welcome all 40 members of the nudist colony here today, thus swelling the congregation. So to speak. Brethren, welcome. And I do hope the verger has made a good job of sandpapering the pews. We all know how painful a piece of pine up the spine can be.
It is no secret.
It is no secret that this service, I've been criticised for it. I've been criticised in many quarters for hoarding this controversial service in my church.
I have been vilified and pillified from evensong to breakfast time.
Obscene notes have been thrust through my letterbox. Indeed, other things have been thrust through my letterbox. Even the front wall of the vicarage has been completely daubed with slogans. Completely. Thus, making it impossible to see the latest one, which is particularly regrettable, because you can't see the word Gomorrah unless you nip round the back. My blessings on you all, and God go with you.
Frankie was at the height of his resurgence when he sadly died from heart failure in April 1992. Frankie Howerd left a legacy of clowning performances and cheeky laughter, having entertained many generations. His unique brand of humour going in and out of favour, yet never getting old. He was quite simply one of a kind. We salute you, Frankie.
You got a minute, haven't you? You sure? Yes, I don't know.
I'm a wit, you know. I'm a wit. Wit.
Not on your Nelly.
Chatter.
Ooh, look. £5 something or other. I must get that little hand put on tomorrow.
Community owing. Ooh! Oh. Can Almighty Caesar spend a drachma in peace?
How dare you?